Let me start with you, Mr. Ahmed. Firstly, Ndifunukwazi, what is that?
It's an organization dedicated to building young leaders on a non-racial basis with a political sense and creating a new discourse and knowledge of our history and global history, but particularly our history, which is lost to young people. And that's a tragedy. And to look at ways of addressing some of the questions that we're going to discuss in the program. Mm.
All right. Again, let me refer to what Dr. Ramphele said to us there a couple of weeks ago. She speaks of a wounded nation. She says the malaise which is holding South Africa back is the woundedness of its people. Do you agree?
There are two questions, I would say, that are related, and it relates to both what Dumula Dlamini said and what Ramphele Ramphele said. Mm. And that is that we're not simply angry. The country is consumed by anger, an anger which goes into our daily lives, into ourselves, into our dreams, into our waking moments, and it affects every personal relationship and every institutional relationship. Mm. And for me, if I may, I just want to analyze the different areas of that anger.
Yeah.
It has to be related to both race, class, actually a race, class, and gender. Mm-hmm. But if you look particularly, I want to start with black African, but let me say at the outset with a bracket that I'm one of those followers of Steve Biko who believe that black covers African, Indian, and colored. So, because it's a political identity. So, black African, in the SJC and in TAC and everywhere I've worked over years, what has come to light in my understanding and in all our understanding is that the anger at community level in African townships is driven primarily and justifiably by the deep inequalities in our society. 40 to 50% of our people will never have a permanent job in their lifetimes. And if you look at young men and young women, it is much, much worse. If you look at the quality of our education system, what's the impact of that anger on our communities? Mm-hmm. The exceptionally violent crime. And the crime takes particular resonance and a very disproportionate burden falls on our township communities. Mm-hmm. And so there's one element of it. I can go into all the problems, but what I want to say is, in the first instance, is that the deep social class gender inequality means that children get beaten at home, women get beaten by husbands or partners or intimate partners. Men beat themselves up and beat up other men and kill other men. And that's a deep thing. When it comes to black colored people, mm-hmm. You find a deep defeated sense. Going back to the experience under slavery and also with the extinguishing and ethnic cleansing of the Khoi people. Mm-hmm. But coming right through to today, there's a sense of alienation from the system. There's a fear of African people, which translates into a deep racial discourse and a racist discourse. And then in relation to Indian and white people, there's a fear. When I look at young white people today, mm-hmm. those who are born post-90, they are not responsible personally for apartheid. But they have inherited a deep historical privilege, which very often they don't acknowledge. And they caught in the middle of what their parents were responsible for. Mm-hmm. And what, when we look at them, all of us, we imagine that they are as responsible as their parents. So they are justifiably angry at that. But they also have a deep sense of guilt because all of us who are middle class, not just white people, when we are confronted with very poor people, black African people, colored people who are alienated and so on, we feel a deep sense of guilt. But that guilt is not transformed by our leaders into action. It is transformed into anger. Mm-hmm. And you can see that on talk shows, on posts on the web and so on. And there is no connection, there is no leadership by our political leaders. So, for instance, what worries me most in the Western Cape, our political leaders, such as our premier, I'm afraid to say, would speak of land invaders when she speaks of people coming from the Eastern Cape, and she's done this in my presence, and I feel that that discourse drives a bigger wedge because of the historic questions around land, but also because it sees it totally misreads what urbanization is about.
Okay.
And then the last question, if you look at Minister Jeff Khadebe's comments on white rule in the Western Cape, on the fact that anyone who objects to the ANC's attempts to amend the constitution as people who want white rule in the Western Cape, I find that deeply offensive, but there's a dangerous discourse coming from our leaders. Mm-hmm. And if I may, we'll come later to what action we need to take about this.
Actually, that's where I'm headed. Because the issue is, and this is why we're listening to you, because you're painting your background of what is happening. This is the situation as you see it. But then I want us to quickly then talk about the interventions.
Yeah.
Intervention one, I think you touched a little bit on leadership's intervention. Perhaps let's put that aside. We'll come back to it. But what is civil society's intervention? What practical intervention should civil society organizations such as yourself and also the media and everyone else, what intervention should we be talking about?
Well, again, the first thing is leadership and the language we use when we actively participate in struggle. The language we use towards each other and towards our opponents, whether it's the inequality created by corporations or whether it is the state. It is very important to maintain a respectful analysis, a respectful address, mm-hmm. but a very firm one that doesn't detract, that doesn't personalize the issues. So leadership in that sense. The second question is creating a non-racialism. Now, I know there are not enough white people to go around to make sure that they across the country in every township because they're a minority. But in the SJC, in equal education, in TAC and so on, but particularly if you look at my colleagues in the SJC and in equal education, they're young white people who work on a daily basis within the poorest communities and go and wade, if I may use online, mm-hmm. In feces, mm-hmm. Literally, to see what is happening. And I think that creates something, a very important bond. But similarly, the area that we have to cross over is that the poorest people need to come into middle-class homes and be able to feel quite comfortable, and so on, and white middle-class people and colored middle-class people don't have to feel guilty. So the non-racialism we create is very important. And then anger can be channeled productively.
Let me just take this then to you, Mandeep. The issue in South Africa is we've got to look at civil society organizations and say, what is the state of health of these organizations? You know, you can talk about TAC, for instance. They have been able to succeed in campaigning for the provision of drugs and so on. But beyond that, what then happens? Are these organizations able to mobilize and keep society active?
I think before I come to that question, I also want to locate South Africa's situation within the global context also. You know, across the world, people are angry. You see the protests that are happening in the Western Hemisphere, the Occupy protests, because of the skewed economic policies, where a small bunch of people actually worked to amass wealth to the detriment of so many people, and their activities caused unemployment and job loss to so many people. So there's that one context.
Fair enough. Yeah.
The second context that there is, and South Africa, and that all impacts on South Africa. Second context is there's a struggle for democratic freedoms that is going on. It's not just in the Middle East. It's in our immediate neighborhood. It's far across, and it's also within South Africa itself, with the secrecy bill and you know the service delivery protests and how they've been clamped down upon. And then there is the issue of climate justice, which is, you know, we are having freak weather patterns. People are really, you know, using up our resources, which is also causing a lot of friction in society with freak weather patterns and some people's livelihoods are being lost, and they, where they live is, are being lost on that. So South Africa has its own peculiar situation, but it also has a, there's also a global context where people are very angry.
And just to pick up on that peculiarity, South Africa, this is happening in a South Africa that is deeply unequal, firstly.
Yes.
In a South Africa that has battled to deal with the legacy of apartheid, where there is still that division along colour lines and all sorts of other things. So the new challenges add to an already extremely difficult set of circumstances.
Absolutely. In fact, it's the most unequal country in the world. It has the dubious distinction of being that. And, you know, and then on one hand, you have conspicuous consumption, which is, you know, you see the lifestyles that some people, that's that a small minority enjoy. And you know, and that's not just a racial issue. You know, wealth has been deracialized, but poverty has not been deracialized. And that is what is causing friction within the country, too. And in this context, civil society is now operating, and it's, you know, and is trying to give policy prescriptions to the, while we have, you know, we, you have a certain amount of freedom to operate. It's much more than in other countries and in the region. But within that context, there is also certain economic policies that are being pursued, which prioritize wealth creation, which, you know, where social justice is not given the emphasis it deserves. Social justice, which is an important pillar, and economic justice, which is an important pillar of the constitution and of the anti-apartheid struggle. And the thing, what has happened in the country is that, you know, 15 years down the line, you know, the first 5 or 7 years are the, you know, the euphoria, the halcyon days where people are still in the glow, the afterglow of the new South Africa. And now people are starting to realize that, you know, well, all is not hunky-dory. But one thing I would really like to point out, and where civil society has an important role to play, is to teach tolerance. And tolerance begins at home. And I think where parents need to teach their children tolerance, now that, you know, that schools are becoming more inclusive, where people from different backgrounds come to school. But when they go home, and if the parents are still using the same old metaphors, and on all sides, you know, the division, that was, I think, the apartheid system's last laugh, where people were slotted into, you look like this, so you behave like this. You look like this, so you eat like this. You look like this. And when they come to school, they forget that. But when they go back home and they see, and the same stereotypes are being reinforced by the parents, and it's subtle, you know, even when people are driving on the street, when the child sits with the parent and the parent says, oh, well, look at him, how he's behaving. This person belongs to this, or is, you know, is selfish or not selfish, belongs to this. So I think that's where civil society has a really important role to play, is also to help adults, you know, to teach tolerance to their children.
We're taking your calls now. Let's start in Welkom. Sidiso on the line. Good morning, Sidiso.
Hi, Kolani. Look, I think I agree with one of the gentlemen that spoke about the leadership. Okay, but then the leadership has got to be from all the South African society in terms of race specifically. We need to see people coming from those communities providing an honest leadership, because currently in South Africa we have a situation where, you know, we're trying to pretend so much, not to engage in honest debate and face reality, you know. That's the first thing. The other thing is that whilst the element of opposition in a democracy is correct, but looking at our reality as South Africans, I think we needed to say post-94, what kind of a South African do we want to see, you know, in the new South Africa? Collectively, what are issues of national interest which everyone would support?
Nareen Chamberlain says, I think that a very good way for white people to help to repay a little towards the past is to just look after the people who work in our homes. They play such an important part in our lives, and as a retired couple in our 60s and 70s, we do as much as we can for our domestic and our gardener. Contrary to what most of the majority in the country think, we do not have a lot of money, so cannot change the world in our country, but at least we can do that. And also, maybe contrary to what many people think, there are plenty of white people who get involved in our churches and clubs and do what we can there as well. It makes my heart very sad when we hear the anger of so many callers to the talk shows who lump all white people in the same pot and let us know their hatred and anger.
Change begins with the individuals, but it's also important for people who are more privileged, and whether they are whatever race they belong to not to just see giving to society as an act of charity. It is something that is their responsibility. It's not something, you know, that they do. It's like it's not crumbs or something. They need to understand that it's for their own future. It's for the future of their own children mm-hmm. and their grandchildren that they need to build a society that is equitable, that where people feel they have a sense of justice, where people feel they have opportunity, and that's what makes a stable society.